is globalnewsforum.com.
It's time now for the Bean Soup Times radio show with your host, Torre Muhammad, heard every Wednesday, 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. Central Standard Time, right here on globalnewsforum.com. And now, your host.
Greetings.
Peace.
Assalamu alaikum. What's up, brothers and sisters? This is your brother, your friend, Torre Muhammad, coming to you with another edition, another program, the Bean Soup Times radio show, hosted here on globalnewsforum.com. I am so excited and happy today, of course, because you can hear my voice, because I am alive on the top side of the earth and thankful to Almighty God for giving me another day to live and survive and strive. Oh, man, happy new year, brothers and sisters. I know we did our first show of the new year last week. But we're still in that Happy New Year spirit and festivities in terms of thinking about what we can be doing new this year that we have not done in previous years, or renewing some things we haven't done. So I just throw that Happy New Year out there to remind you that if you do have some resolutions, hold on to them. Don't let them go. Keep focusing and keep striving to be all that you strive to be. Man, we have a fantastic show today. I'm talking about just absolutely fantastic. We have an incredible guest on the show today that I know you're going to enjoy the words of wisdom and inspiration that they provide. So, but of course, before we go any further, I want to make sure that everyone knows what Bean Soup Time is and what we do. We are a media marketing and publicity company, and we take great pride in helping you get the message out about your product, your service, your event, or your cause. We love to promote black-owned products and services. We love it because when we see a black business with a wonderful product or a great service, it just does so much to inspire and motivate me and so many other people who could benefit from seeing black businesses in operation. We often talk, and you can hear people talk about the importance of seeing examples, the importance of role models. Well, black businesses are role models. They're given an example of what can and could be done. And so we must do it. We don't have any other choice but to really wrap our arms around each other and understand that the solution to the lack of jobs, the solution to the problems that we see in education, the solutions to we see to the problems in the downtrodden or the denigration and the destruction of our communities, the violence, the death, and the destruction, can be solved through us pooling our resources and uniting and making sure that we can take responsibility for strengthening and upkeeping and uplifting our own community. That is nobody else's responsibility but our own. And so black businesses play a big role in that, because once money starts circulating amongst the businesses, then those businesses that you patronize can start working together more and go to places where they can get their products, good products, at a cheaper price. If they're making their product, then they can start hiring people and bringing on your children, your nieces and nephews who maybe are looking for an intern or a summer job. And these things can grow from there to now that person who now has a summer job won't decide to be out in the streets doing something they don't need to be doing because they have something to do. Our people, our children need some type of vision that they can believe in, of the future that will cause them to know that them wasting time and them doing things that would destroy their future doesn't make sense. See, but when young people, and older people for that matter of fact, don't see a future for themselves, they don't see a vision that they are a part of, where they can be a part of something bigger, where they can really see legitimately how they can be a part of something, then that's when you see the destruction and the death and the violence. People don't see anything for them to do, and they lost hope in the whole idea of going to school, getting a good education, and getting a college degree, and finding a good job, and that job will take care of you for 40, 50 years, and you can retire and have pension money. And see, all that stuff is, you can't sell that dream to people anymore. And so entrepreneurism, regardless of what other people are doing outside of your own environment, outside of your own ability to control, you have the ability to control a whole lot. And we, if we can see birds flying and finding worms, and you can see squirrels getting up humping every day finding food, if you can see different animals being able to find food, then surely we can too, making homes for themselves. Yes, it's that time and it's that hour. And so one of the things that, of course, we have to do is, there's really two keys to success when it comes to building businesses who can then take care of everything else in the community. Either you got to know how to make something, or you got to know how to sell something. It's just that simple. When you study big businesses, when you study people who have made it big in business, either they were making something or they were selling something. Now, of course, some make and sell, but sometimes somebody knows how to make something and they find somebody who knows how to sell something. And when those two get married together, it's unstoppable. It's absolutely unstoppable. So that's what we have to do. We can do no better than either find out what you can make, create something, or learn how to sell. And with that kind of combination, man, I'm telling you, unstoppable. Hey, what's that song? Ain't no stopping us now. We're on the move. Oh, my daughter would be cringing to know I'm trying to sing. She looks at me like I have lost my complete natural mind when I try to sing. It's all good, though. So, like I say, brothers and sisters, we have a great show today. I have a young lady I want to introduce you all to. She is, you've probably walked past her product before. You may have bought her product before. I'm sure many of you have bought her product because it's been around for 28 years. So I know you've bought her product before, or you've walked past it in a grocery store. And maybe you didn't know that it was a black-owned product. Maybe you didn't know that it was a black woman from Chicago who has created this wonderful product. And so I want to introduce you all to her. And I tell you, you know, just really, man, get a piece of pencil. I mean, not a piece of pencil, but a piece of paper and a pencil or a pen, or make sure you buy your mind to open up a Word document and take some notes, because you're going to get some good information from this 28-year veteran in the game of business. So without any further ado, I want to bring to you, I talked to her a little bit earlier today, and because she didn't have time to get to the studio, but I wanted to make sure you all heard from her. So without any further ado, let me introduce you all to the great young lady coming before us in a few seconds.
As I always tell you, we deliver on the promise of bringing to you phenomenal, incredible people in the city of Chicago and beyond. And today is no different. I have the wonderful pleasure of introducing to you a young lady who was full of energy, commitment, and passion, and just has a knack for business. She is, I'm telling you, she is a Chicago icon and phenomenon. She started off with her product, some delicious pancake syrup, that was in one store when she first started, and now it is in 10,000 plus stores nationwide. You've probably seen her on the cover of dozens of newspapers and magazines, including Essence, Black Enterprise, People, Fortune, the National Enquirer, and she's been on the holy grail of media outlets, the Oprah Winfrey Show, not one time, not two times, but three times. She has been on the Oprah Winfrey Show. And now today she is on Bean Soup Times Radio. Brothers and sisters, I want to introduce to you Michele Hoskins. How you doing?
I'm doing great, Tori. I'm doing fantastic. How are you?
I am doing so wonderful today. It's a pleasure to have you on the show.
It's good to be here on a spring-like day.
We got right.
to take this day and embrace it, because tomorrow we're going to have some snow.
That's right. That's right.
You got to enjoy it. Your last jog down the lake.
Right. Get that last jog in.
Hit that last jog in. Hit that last ball.
Well, you know, you're talking about Southsiders. Northsiders would jog in any kind of weather. That's right. So tell us, you've been in business for 28 years. You have Michele Foods produces honey cream syrup, three different flavors. And how did this all come about? How did you get this idea to get into an industry that not a lot of black folks are in, which is, you know, retail food?
We need to get in it, because what we are consumers, and we need to not be consumers. You know, I got into this industry, you know, it was 28 years ago, Tori. I was trying to figure out how to be successful, and no one had taught me that. You know, I don't think many of us were taught how to be successful. We were taught maybe how to work, how to graduate out of school and get a job, but how do you become successful? And I had read in the 80s that was a decade of women, and that women were going to emerge as CEOs and executives of companies. Mm. And I'm like, wow, that's really interesting. And I'm like, well, I'm a woman, you know, how do I get to be part of this movement? And it was two ways to do that. Either go back to school and get more education, because I was a teacher, or I could, hey, start my own company. I could be my own CEO. I could just come out to that CEO of Michele something, right?
Right.
And that's how I literally started with a vision of just being successful. And then I looked around me and I said, okay, now what can help me be successful? And at the same time, I was pondering that, we had a recipe in our family that had been passed down to four generations. So my great-great-grandmother, who was emancipated and stayed on the family as a cook for the family that had enslaved her mom. And so she had this recipe that she had passed down made out of honey, butter, and cream. And it was a secret, and it was good, and we all enjoyed it. And I said, wow, why can't I take this recipe and make it into my success story? I had no knowledge of anything. I couldn't even spell entrepreneur. I had no knowledge of this at all, but I had this vision and this passion to be successful and hopefully leave my children a legacy.
Wow, that's beautiful.
That's how I kind of started. Just kind of started with a vision, sitting in my condo on the south side of Chicago, trying to figure out how I was going to pay the rent.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was not going to, you know, keep this thing going. And
when you say figuring out how to pay the rent, so you didn't have a huge trust fund from your parents. You didn't have a lot of money given to you to start the business.
I had nothing. In fact, I didn't have any. I didn't have any money. I didn't have, you know, the bank accounts and all those things. So it started in business. I knew that I would have to have some kind of capital. So what I did basically was I sold everything that I had accumulated. I mean, car, furniture, you know, my daughter's Jordans, whatever. I had accumulated that.
You sold the Jordans.
I sold the Jordans. That I should have kept. Jordan. That could have been a small investment into something right now. But, you know, I sold everything that I owned, and, you know, as my mom could, I moved back into her home, and of course, you know, south side of Chicago, little homes, all she had was an attic.
Mm-hmm.
So she, you know, raised the attic, and I moved in, you know, me and my three daughters, and I started making syrup in the basement, and I was working as a teacher. The school that I worked for, for Aquinas, and Aquinas at that time was closing, and I didn't want to go to Unity and teach. I said, well, I'll just, you know, do this full time, but that wasn't very feasible, and so I went on welfare for about 9 months and started my company in my mom's basement. And I remember it's just, you know, I was thinking about all that today going back, but it's been a really interesting journey.
Wow. And so you're talking 28 years ago, there were not, you know, there's more today than there was back then.
Oh, yeah.
But there were not a lot of black businesses, black products on the shelves in major stores throughout the country. So how did you figure out your way?
Well, you know what happened was, you know, God is so good. And what happened was, I don't know if you remember, around that time, I don't know if you remember, Jesse Jackson had that protest on 71st, I think, of that first jewel store for hair care. And they were asking for shelf space and things like that. And we were really just in the hair care business. Mm-hmm. And that's basically what blacks were doing.
Right.
We were like, okay, making, you know, pomade and whatever.
Right.
And I kind of slid in, you know, I kind of like, it was like the door was kind of closed, and I kind of slid through that door because at that time, I had just formulated the product, and I had some bottles of the product, and I had muddled through and had gotten enough to actually have a finished product. You know, I had, you know, figured out how to formulate it, figure out how to get it co-packed. And so I went to Jules Corporate, and really, I mean, they had never seen anyone like me walk into Corporate Jules. The lady, in fact, was, when I walked in, she said, well, you know, what are you here for? Because at that time, all the yuppies were standing around with their little briefcase, and everybody was, it was Snow White in there. Mm-hmm. And I said, I came in to see a buyer to sell my product. And she set me in a corner for about 3 or 4 hours. So it was a very good lesson because I was able to observe the process. And I just walked in and talked to the buyer, and I told him I had this product. He said, well, who are you? I said, well, I'm Michelle. He said, what's the name of the company? I said, Michele Foods. He said, well, what's the name of the product? I said, Michele Syrup. And he said, well, you know, I've never seen anyone, CEO, walk into you know, corporate, especially talk to me as a buyer to own something that they had their name on. He said, let's try this out. And he said, and we'll, you know, if my grandson likes this product, he said, I'll give you some distribution. And a couple of days later, Tori came back and said, I'm going to give you every Jewel food store.
Wow.
And that was 28 years ago with one product. And it was funny because when I waited for it to hit the shelf, I used to take my daughters to Jewel's up here in 115th and Hostel. We lived over in at the time in Rose, which was a little bit better then. And we would go up there every Saturday and dress up to go watch the product to get, you know, placed on the shelf. And then
right.
We didn't see it. And one Saturday we went up there, and I was just in some raggedy blue jeans and a cap on. I was going to get milk and bread.
Uh-huh.
And it was on the shelf, and I screamed and hollered, and security took me out the store. They looked at me. I told them, this is my product. And they said, oh, get this woman. Because, you know, I look like what I was on welfare, and I had this little girl with this nappy hair. That's mine. And it was funny because it was just all so surreal. It just wasn't something that had ever, you know, there was no map for this.
Right.
You know,
wow.
I had no roadmap for it.
That's phenomenal. I mean, you absolutely are a pioneer. A pioneer, yeah. Forges a way for others and create opportunities. And you opened up and made a way for yourself. And you now even have counseled and given advice and tutored others on how to get their product into market.
Yeah, I mentored Magnolia Tea. I mean, Mikel Beater walked in my office with a big old jug of tea and said, I want to put this on the market. I said, let's figure it out. And then Amy with Comfort Cakes. And so since then, I've mentored about 75 people. About 35 of them are very successful over a 10-year period. So that's when I kind of sit down and said, you know what, I have to learn how to give back because no one mentioned me. There was no one I could pick up the phone and say, how do you do this? And because I have done it and had to, like you say, knock down some trees and get, you know, a little scratched up, you know, I retained that knowledge, you know, and I kind of kept that knowledge and I put it in the book and I said, you know, I'm going to teach people. It's simple, from recipe to retail. That's what I went from a recipe product to a retail product. And there's a process. And a lot of people don't understand the process. And so I teach that process because it's a knowledge process. But what I teach people how to do is to do the key thing to build on wealth, Tori, and that's making money while you're sleeping. Because, you know, you should have about 4 or 5 streams of income. And so if you could develop an income where it's making money for you while I'm sitting here talking to you, I'm hoping somebody in this world has found a bottle of honey cream, a butter pecan, a maple somewhere and creating an invoice. And that's the key to building wealth, so you can take your time and energies to do some of the other things in life that God has given you the blessings to do, and that is to help others, to be able to, you know, teach others, to be able to show what you've taken your time to learn how to do. So I'm very proud of my Recipe to Retail program. And when people come and take the course and they're very serious about putting it on the market, they end up having a product that is retail ready.
Wow. That's beautiful. We definitely commend you for that. And we definitely, we've heard and seen some of the products that you've helped to get on the shelf. Isn't it also sweet potato pound cake? With real
yeah,
men
oh,
cook?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yvette, and I said, I remember we sat on her boat one summer, and I was telling her about it, and I said, Yvette, come on now, let's put this in a box and let's put it on the shelf. And so we had a sweet potato pound cake. Here locally, we have, I've helped Amy Hillary with comfort cakes, Magnolia Teas, and Yvette. Then I have a lot of other, because most of my clients come from out of state.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a guy that, in fact, coming here in January. He has a salsa, and he's in every commissary in the military, doing so well.
Mm, wow.
And then I have a girl that has a great green recipe, and she's in the South. And I have a girl that has, so these people have really emerged, and they've taken the lessons. So,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's...
Smoking Joe's hot sauce?
Yeah, uh-huh. So it's been a real that's where I kind of get my joy from, because... You can't get this information. It's not in a book. It's no one really wants to give it to you if they have it, because it's a roadmap to success.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, it's putting you in a place. And I say it's very few of us out here on the market, so there's room for us.
Right.
You know, there's room for products that we make. And our biggest challenge, as you know, since when we hooked up, is consumer awareness, letting the consumer know about these great products, because
right.
It would be great if the store would tell them.
Right.
Great. You can walk into a store and Jules will say, okay, great. There's 25 African-American products, there's 15 Asian products, there's 25 Hispanic products. So here they are, and these are the aisles they're in. But they won't tell you that. You have to get that word out yourself.
That's a beautiful lesson. So one part of the piece is getting your product on a shelf, and the other part is making sure that people know about it, marketing
right.
yourself.
And what I try to tell people, and I show people, this is very, very important, the smaller the company, the longer the shelf life. And so I show them how to have a shelf life with a product, because you need to be able to do all the work, get it on the market, on the shelf, and then go out and market it.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't want to have anything that's going to look around and 3 or 4 days later. And a lot of people come in with fresh products or pies or things that they feel like they can just take out of oven and put on the shelf, but that's not the method.
Mm-hmm.
The method is to have longevity and to be able to sit there, like with Yvette's pound cake, and be able to go out and market that and tell
mm-hmm.
people and still
mm-hmm.
have that shelf space there and that fresh product when someone comes in to purchase it.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's a process, but it's, and like I said, I had no teacher, so I had to learn the hard way, but that's the best way, because once you learn the hard way, you know it. It is engraved in your psychic, in your brain.
Right, right.
You don't forget it, you know.
Wow, that's beautiful. Brothers and sisters, we're listening to Bean Soup Times Radio, and we are talking with Michele Hoskins of Michele Foods, that creates some delicious honey cream syrups, a butter pecan, a maple, and a honey cream that are just absolutely delicious. And Michele, I have another question for you. When you got started, okay, so you already told us that you didn't have a lot of resources and money, but you just had a commitment. Did you have to make sure that everything was perfect before you got started, or I seen your office space now. You have a beautiful office space, just looks wonderful. How did, was that the beginning, and did you start like that?
No, I started, you know what, I started in my mom's basement.
Mm-hmm.
And then I always tell people when I mentor them that you do need to have a face to your business. You want to be professional. So I went to a small little space on the south side, and I bartered time. And so, it didn't start off like it's ending up. And it started off with just day by day persevering, being very persistent,
mm-hmm.
being very passionate, and being very committed, you know. And I always tell people that when you get when you're called to your calling or your passion, it becomes the only game in town for you.
Mm.
And it's not centered around monetary gain. It's centered around the happiness and the passion of what you're doing. And the money will come. You know, the money will come in and go out. And I really try to explain to people, don't put a lot of emphasis on money, because money system means it exchanges an energy. You know, and a lot of people put too much emphasis on the energy of money and not the energy of what's going to generate the money.
Oh,
and when you learn how to put your energy into what's going to generate the money, it becomes fun. Just like if someone that, you know, like, you know, just say, you know, like, look at D. Rose. I mean, you think he's counting baskets. He's counting three throws. You know,
right.
He's counting the energy. He's hyped up about that, and he was probably having the same energy when he was on the concrete on the south side playing ball that he has now. But look at what the energy and the passion has brought him. It's brought him comfort and money.
Right.
So, you know, it doesn't start off easy. And I don't even want to say easy. I think it just starts off day to day, you know, with this passion, getting up, trying to, you know, think about the. And always, what I do is I visualize the end result. And the end result for me was always the visualization of seeing this product on the shelf.
Mm-hmm.
And then seeing it in not one store, but 10 stores, 20 stores, and then a national product. And so I still visualize that. I still visualize where else I want to go. You know, you and I have been visualizing some stuff and manifesting
mm-hmm.
some of the things we've talked about.
That's right.
So, no, it didn't start off like that, and it's still not an easy road. I mean, I still have a lot of challenges, but, you know, like one, like Helvita of Magnolia Tea told me, said, Michele, one thing about it, you can't get fired. So, that's a good
right,
thing.
That's right.
You know, you've created your own destiny. And I believe people write their own destiny. And I think that everyone out there has a blank journal, and we write our destiny. And I think what we do wrong, Corey, is we write after the fact. We write the story after the day has happened. But I think that what I do is I write the story before the day happens. And then if there's something in my day that wasn't quite something that I planned, I try to divert from it.
Right.
I say, well, you know, this is not what I, you know, I didn't put this in here. And I try to figure out, you know, whose problem is that? Is that yours or mine? Because I didn't create that problem. So it just started off like this, and it's still a journey. It hasn't ended, you know. It's still everyday, ongoing challenge.
Man, that's beautiful. You remind me of a scripture that says, write the vision and make it plain.
Mm-hmm.
You
yeah, we all write it. And what we write, what people don't realize is we write and create our own destiny about what we say and what we do. And we just sometimes aimlessly do things without any thought to it.
Right.
And
that's right.
And when you do that, you'll end up, you know, being a little bit thrown off, a little bit confused. But if you put thought to it in the beginning of your day and prayer to it, then, you know, the only way it has to manifest, because that is what you are creating, and we are creators.
Mm-hmm.
That's what God gave us, the ability to be a free will creator.
That's right. That's right. And so, and people can get in touch with you via your website, michellefoods.com, and
with
you
one
have
L.
a Facebook. Right, with one L, Michele Foods with one L. Michele's Foods.
With one L. Facebook, Twitter, you know, I'm here. I'm a Chicago-based girl. I'm here majority of the time. And we're doing, you know, our recipe contest.
Yes.
Kind of helping me and spearheading for me. We're, so we have a lot of things going. So if you want to visit the website and visit, you know, and send me a shout-out on Facebook, I would definitely, respond back. If there's anyone out there that wants to put something on the market, just call me. You know, if you want to, you know, some advice about retail or business, give me a call. I'm very accessible.
Oh, that's beautiful. That is absolutely beautiful. And yes, you mentioned the recipe contest where folks can submit a original recipe using one of your three syrups, and they're going to get all types of wonderful recognition and some free groceries and visibility
and
a book. It's all kind of stuff.
Yeah, we're going to do a cookbook, and their product will be in our cookbook. So, you know, the product is very versatile. We all these syrups out here really you can cook with. So I've had people submit recipes for years. I mean, all kind of recipes, from short ribs of beef to honey loaves. And so I thought it would be really great to compile these recipes and put them in the book, but I didn't have enough. So I'm saying, if I run this recipe contest and I get, you know, people to go buy the product and come up with this, these wonderful recipes, we'll put them in a book. They'll get that recognition. But the winner of the recipe contest will get free groceries for a year. The second place winner will get free groceries for 6 months. And the third place winner will get groceries for 3 months.
Ooh, that's beautiful.
Yeah, then they also will be, you know, we'll have, you know, a night out with Michele. We'll go out and have dinner. And we'll have some news press. And then from that, we are going to looking for someone that's going to have the best recipe that I've mentored, and then actually get them distribution on the retail shelf. So there's a lot of good things going on. You know, I've gotten, you know, some energy to do some other things now since the company has kind of grown and kind of settled in. So I'm able to, you know, to expand and put my wings other places and see what I can help other people do.
That is so wonderful. So I mean, I just have to reiterate that because that's absolutely incredible. Somebody that is listening now, or somebody that has a friend or a family member with a recipe that can use Michele's honey cream syrup, can take that recipe like you did with your family's recipe from the kitchen to major chefs throughout the country. And all they have to do is get into the contest. And if it's a great recipe, you're going to work with it. That's absolutely beautiful.
Right. And then there's just someone out there that feels like even now that they have something unique and different that's in their family's recipe box or it's been passed down, or this great recipe that their grandmother has given them. They should contact me and see if they want to get mentored and really put this on a retail shelf, because, you know, look at Magnolia. She's got teas out there, and she just had this wonderful fresh tea recipe, and she's expanding into lemonades and all kind of stuff. And she has great, she's in Whole Foods, she's in Jewel.
Right.
Same thing with Yvette. Yvette had this pound cake. So, you know, you look at all the recipes, this retail industry, Tori, is a $500 billion a day industry.
Billion with a B.
Oh, with a B.
Whew, that's a lot of money.
And that's how much we spend on a week. Mm-hmm. Many people going to a retail store on a corner. So you have to think about, that is one of the main consumptions that we have is food.
Right.
And so why are we not as Afro-Americans in this industry?
Right.
And it's the largest industry. Because I don't care what happens in the world, you're going to go eat.
Yeah, you are going to eat.
You're going to eat. Now, you might not have money to go buy that hamburger, but you're going to go find and some butter, some peanut butter,
right,
to make you something.
That's
so
right.
We have to go into the food store to eat. So why not be a part of this industry? Why not figure out something that we like or we want to partake in or we eat that we love? Why not try to put that somewhere in some kind of store that we can tell people, look, go get something I've made. That's all I did. I tell people I started with three ingredients: honey butter.
Wow.
I started a company.
And it's a multi-million-dollar company.
Three ingredients. Right.
Wow.
Now that product is intense. So just think how, I don't want to say it's simple and easy, but there's a process that gets you there.
Right. That's so beautiful. That's so beautiful that not only you had the tenacity and courage to do it, and you did this as a single parent with three daughters?
Single parent with three daughters. Going through grammar school, high school, college, and now two of them work for me. One of them has been with me 18 years, going 19 years, and I have my other daughter's been with me 10 years, so I kind of created them a job, too.
Right.
And so they work for me, which is good, because now, you know, I don't have to worry about them being fired anywhere.
Right.
So it becomes what you dream. I mean, you sit back and it's no reason to sit down and be sad and unhappy and trying to figure stuff out. All you have to do is just get up and just shake it off and say, okay, God, point me in the right direction. Because it's there. You know, we all have the ability to be who we want to be. And I think that once we realize that and once we get away from other people, get other people out of our heads and put in what we know
right.
to be true, then we're on our way.
Right. That's
and
beautiful.
I'm just
good
blessed
advice.
To be able to help some other people that are looking in my direction.
That's so beautiful. And so, I mean, brothers and sisters, you hear just the great wisdom and advice coming from Michele Hoskins, and she has also written a book, Sweet Expectations, where you give your recipes for success, and it's just full of life lessons on business and life.
right.
That
yeah,
you put in there.
It's a story of you know, I don't want to say the struggles, but the challenges that I had, you know, the health challenges, the challenges with the retail, you know, talking to, you know, having to sit as a young black woman in front of white buyers that had a whole different language for me and had a different,
right.
whole different persona about me and I, you know, things that you just have to build character, you know, it's built a certain character for me that I probably didn't have 28 years ago, you know, but it's also, you know, made me stay humble because I know what I had to go through, what I had to do, and I know I'm still going through it and I'm still doing it. It has not, you know, it's not a lot of it has changed.
Right.
And that's why, you know, as consumers, we need to know who to support to make not only a difference in our lives, but to make a difference in society, you know, in society, to say, you know, we support our own. And I think that the disadvantage is that they just, the consumer or the customer or the person on the other end just does not know who to support. And so we have to have vehicles, and you're a great vehicle for that, Tori, to be able to tell your audience and tell people, these are the products out here that we should support. There are many of them, Reggio's, Grandma Ma's. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's an array of products on the retail shelf in Jewel's. I think it's about 34 African-American products.
Grandma Ma's is black-owned?
Yeah, Grandma Ma's is owned by African-American Brother.
Wow.
Right here in Chicago. And we're going to be showcased at the Cultural Center in February for Black History Month. All the black vendors are going to be there. I had a meeting yesterday, Tori. It's 400 of us out here.
400?
Afro-American products nationwide. And there are more products, Afro-American products in Jewel Food Store than anywhere in the country.
Wow.
They're all here in Jewel.
Wow, that's beautiful. That's definitely good to know. We need to know.
You need to know who they are, because
that's
Grandma
right.
Miles is a black brother named Paul Fiché. He's right in Hyde Park, and he has some dried beans, and those are his products. And then you have, and then you need to know who's not African-American. Gloria's not owned by African-American.
What? I thought Gloria was black-owned.
Sylvia's not an African-American product, no.
Sylvia's not either?
Baby Ray's is not an African-American product.
Wow.
Baby Ray's is owned by a white company. Sylvia's owned by a white company, and so is Glory.
Wow.
So, you know, we need to know that. And we need to know.
That's right.
We need to know. So people should go in and start to ask, what black products are here? Diversity products, because they're all mixed into the shell.
Right,
we have
right.
African-American hot sauce and beans, and we have, you know, greens. We have a lot. And I'll send you the list one day, and maybe you could just send a shout-out.
Yes.
Because the consumer needs to know who we are.
That's
and
right.
That's why I put my picture on my product. It is surfaced probably in about 3 months. It's got to go through the system.
That's right.
But people need to know that you know, Uncle Ben and Auntie Mama are not real.
Right. That's right.
And who's real.
And who's real.
Support someone, right? Support us, because we can help build economic development within our own community.
Right. That's it. That's it.
That's it. That's the key.
Yes,
you know,
ma'am.
Sharing it, that's the key. So, yeah, it's a lot.
I didn't know Grandma Ma's was black on.
See,
yep, I sure did.
I can tell Paul. See, Paul needs, they need to get with you and get the word out.
Mm-hmm. See, one thing I've learned that is it's an actual fact in business and marketing, that people buy from people that they know, like, and trust.
Mm-hmm.
And people know, like, and trust people who are just like them.
and then when you walk up and say something to them, they say something back.
Right, that's right.
You know? I get my head down the south side. I go into that south side beauty shop. I sit down there, and I'll be there for a minute, and I ask, oh no, I've never heard about it. And as soon as the next week they come in, oh, I bought some. Yeah, because I'm just like you.
That's right.
I get my hair done just like you get. I get my nails done. You know, I travel like you do. I'm on the same roads you on. But, you know, I had this product, and it's just that, you know, if I was just an African-American, because this is what, what's his name, Mike, you know what I'm talking about, Michael Bates.
Bates, mm-hmm.
I did a show, I've done his show several times, and we talked once, and he said, Michele, if you were just an African-American, sir, if you were just serve of choice of the African-American consumer, I would not have to look back. I could hire... I could have my own plant.
Right.
You know, because that we're a strong consumer. We're a $1 trillion consumer.
That's right. That's right.
And who are we giving it to?
That's right.
Who's coming that we building up?
That's right. Right.
We're building
somebody
up the crafts and the General Mills, and we build it, and you can't even go there and get a job.
Right. That's right.
You know, they're not even your community. It's hard to get them to even sponsor an event for you.
Right. That's right.
So we're supporting them every time we pull something off the shelf. Bisquick and Auntie Mama and Smucker. We're doing that. Why can't we have jellies and jams on the market and pancake batter and stuff?
That's right.
We can do that.
That's right.
It's just a matter of a mindset,
that's
you know,
right.
of figuring out how to get this done, you know?
That's right. That's
and,
right.
and that's where I step in, because a guy that has a salsa, he's doing great. In fact, I said he'll be in January. He's got all the commissaries for the military.
That's beautiful.
Salsa.
That's beautiful. Yes. Yeah, it is. It's so important for the strength and vitality
and
of our community.
And not even us, but to teach our children.
That's
that.
Right.
Okay, we might miss the boat. We might say, okay, great, I don't feel like doing it. I'm about to retire. But here you have children coming up.
Right.
In a society that this energy is going to consistently grow. It's not going to go anywhere. And you should also think about, well, maybe it's something I should teach them to do.
Right, that's right.
You know, even from the standpoint, Tori, of going and learning how to be a product developer, how to run a plant,
mm-hmm.
how to work inside a manufacturing plant.
That's right.
Because those jobs, I'm telling you, they do not have a lack of jobs in this industry.
Right. There's stuff being made because you see it on the shelf and people are buying it.
People
product
buying
is
it.
Being moved. And that is the key.
You go to a supermarket, how long do you stay in line before you get checked out?
Oh, it depends on what time of the day, but it's always a line.
It's always a line, and it's always food. It's never a lack of it.
That's right.
It's always 100 tomatoes there. It's always everything you, because they constantly stocking us every night.
They constantly
ordering. Trucks are coming in. This is the biggest industry out here. And we need to, as Afro-Americans, need to know how to fit in some kind of way. Whether you have a product on the market, whether you're somewhere managing a retail chain or somewhere learning how to do product
mm-hmm.
development or working on one of the machines. Even in plants, Corey, the co-packing plants, there are no Afro-Americans in those plants.
Right, right. That's right.
You know, the closest they might get is driving a truck up to the dock.
Mm-hmm. And that's beautiful. Brothers and sisters, you're listening to Bean Soup Times Radio. I'm your host, Tori Muhammad, and we are interviewing the great Michele Hoskins. Now, let us know also, Michele, where people can get. Of course, we have people all throughout Chicago. Then you have throughout the country. And even if they can't find it, where can they get it?
Okay, well, you know, right here in Chicago, we're in Jewel's Diamonds, of course. We're in Ultra. We're in Waltz. We're in the majority of the retail stores here in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
Then outside Chicago, we're in the Kroger chains. We're in Publix. We're in AT Bus. That puts us in Texas. That puts us in California. Puts us in Florida. In Atlanta. Puts us in the South. It puts us in the Carolinas. So it kind of gives us that kind of national presence.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you can't find it, or if your relative can't find it, you can always order it online at michellefoods.com, Michele with an L, and we have an online store there. So you can get it in a multitude of ways. But my Chicagoland brothers and sisters, I've been on Jewel's shelf for 28 years, and I know you probably have. The ones that haven't seen me have just walked by me, and maybe the ones that have seen me have not recognized that it's been an Afro-American product. But that's where we are. You know, we're looking to continually grow. We're in a lot of small, you know, little boutique shops to food distributors.
Mm-hmm.
But we're still, you know, still trying to get placement, still trying to grow the brand because, like, Auntie Mama's everywhere and we're not. So we, you know, on her tail. But you know, and you can always communicate with me by my email
mm-hmm.
and by my Facebook page, Michele Foods Facebook.
That's beautiful. Yes, and you are all over Facebook and Twitter and LinkedIn. You definitely are using modern tools to help get the message out and to share your good news.
Yeah, social media puts everybody almost on the same level because now, my daughter told me yesterday that that there was a company, I think she went on, she said Smuckers has a Facebook page. So everybody has Facebook. Mm. We call it coming out the gate, and you're the guru of that. I mean, I reached out to Tori. I am not, you know, computer savvy. I mean, I know how to, you know, open an email and how to send an email, but all that other stuff is just kind of new to me. And Tori has been my best friend in this business as far as social media. So I owe you such a big hug because you have really exposed me to the social media piece, and that's very important for my business right now. I think it's very important that we as business owners understand how to use Twitter and how to definitely use Tori to help us get the word out because we don't have time to sit and do all this, and he knows how to do it. So I so appreciate you for this. I mean, really, I had a vision about this, you know, social media, and you have made the reality of it come to life for me, Tori, and I really totally appreciate you for that.
Oh, well, we thank you. I thank you so much. It's absolutely my pleasure, and I really appreciate you give me the opportunity to do it. You know, there's so much wisdom and lessons that just being in your presence that I get. So it's definitely a wonderful win-win. And I just love helping to share news about, you know, great products and black-owned businesses. So, you know, just to work with you is feeding my soul. It's an absolute joy.
Yes, feed both of our souls. I mean, it was a meant to be relationship, and I'm glad it's manifested. It's happened, and it's given us all, you know, experience and energies and things where we can, you know, build on to help other people. We
That's
learn
right.
from our experiences, and we take those same experiences and help other people. So, you know, the people that are around me, you know, I'm learning how to tell them about you and you know, how to get the word out, and they see what you're doing for me. So this is all about helping each other and growing and helping our brothers and sisters, because if we don't do it, who's going to do it for us? We've been waiting for years for people to step in and say, okay, I'm coming in the hood to help y'all. It ain't happening. We got to come out the hood to help other people. And so the ones of us that are here, that have been raised here on the south side, west side, north side of Chicago, east side, it's time for us to know who we are and what we're doing and help each other, however, whatever means necessary. You know, so I'm just glad that, you know, I'm still here and I'm still available and I'm able to talk about what I've done, and I'm able to look back and in retrospect and say, you know, it's been a good ride. I'm still riding, I'm still pedaling, but it's been a good ride, and I hope everyone in Tori's listening audience, you know, gets encouragement from myself and from him, that anything that mind can conceive can manifest through hard work, perseverance, and faith. It can happen. It's no, that's the reality. That's more of a reality than a reality.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
You know, it really is, because your reality is like, sometimes like, wow, this sucks. But your real reality of what you can create is where the blessings are.
Wow, that's
and
beautiful.
And God has given us all of that. I mean, he has not shortchanged anybody. He poured equal amounts out of everybody's cup, believe me. He measured it, made sure everybody had the same amount. He had a very specific measuring cup, and everybody got the same amount of blessings.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just that we need to pour from those blessings and understand that we all have them. And that maybe we might need to nudge our sister and brother next to us, say, hey, help me, you know, pick up my jug. But, you know, that's what we're here for. And that's what the ones that have poured from that blessing are here to show other people how to pour theirs.
That's right. That's beautiful. Well, brothers and sisters, I encourage each and every one of you, go to your local store, go to Jules, go to Dominic's, get some honey syrup today, get in the recipe contest. Figure out if you have a recipe. I'm telling you, this is the contest to be in, because there are so many blessings and opportunities that could come from you taking that family recipe and putting it into the contest. And who knows, in 2 or 3 years, 5 years, you could be in major stores across the country building a legacy for yourself and your family. And go to michellefoods.com, Michelle with one L, michellefoods.com. If you're not in the area where you can find it, go online and get it. And also, her book, Michelle's book, is there available. She has 42 tips, recipes for success. Recipe for success. 42 tips in there, taken from her life's lessons. I'm telling you, I read this book in about 2 days, and I was so moved and inspired by this book, Michelle. It's just an absolute wonderful read, just full of clarity, both in the reading and the simplicity of the way you wrote it, as well as the clarity of moments that you had during different stages of your business growth. So I encourage everybody, this is a book you need to read to kick off the new year if you are in business or are thinking about being in business, or if you just want to be inspired to be the greatest you want to be. Get Sweet Expectations by Michele Hoskins at michellefoods.com.
Yeah, they can get it on the website. Yeah, and I sometimes stop and read that book myself. Let me think about this. Did I do this? Okay, let me go back to this book. So it was a book that I mean, it's almost like talking to me, because I wrote it like that. I wrote it like, you
yes,
know, having a conversation with somebody. And, you know, the ups and downs and the things, the good things that have happened, the bad things. I talk about the Oprah experience. So it's been a good ride. And I was really thinking, this interview is really on time, because I was left this morning thinking about, kind of in retrospect, going back to when I first started to figure out, okay, you know, was this, did you really do this? Did this really happen? And so I really appreciate you, Tori, putting me in front of your audience for me to be able to talk and let them know a little bit about who I am. I'm a sister from Chicago, and I'm very accessible. You can hit me up on my email or my web or my Twitter account now and my Facebook. I mean, I'm like really sophisticated now.
That's right.
Twitter, Facebook, and all these things that everyone else has. And I would enjoy hearing from you. If anyone out there, you know, wants to get in touch with me for the mentoring program, feel free to give me a call. If you want to get the book, you can get that online. Or if you want to just go buy some syrup from your local Jules or Dominic's or local store, please do that. If you have a recipe that you want to put some syrup in and send to me, let's see if you can, you know, be a contest winner. So there's a lot of good things going on. It's a new year. We all have a fresh start, and let's make something of 2000. So let's make this our year.
That's what's up. That is so beautiful. Thank you so much, Michele, for being on the show, and thank you for all that you're doing to be a pioneer, an inspiration, and to just, you know, of course, we didn't really talk about this a lot because we were talking about all the aspects of business and all that you've done, but make no mistake about it. To be on the shelf for 28 years, the product has got to be fantastic, and it is. I love it. I love it on waffles and pancakes. I love it on ice cream. And desserts. It's very versatile. So just, I love it. Just an excellent product.
And that is, Tori, to your end of this, that is, I mean, after everything is said and done, to be there sitting 28 years does mean that the product has some validity to it. So the product is good. I think it's one of the best syrups out there, and it's so versatile. So, you know, try it, and when you try it, just give me a shout. Tell me if you like it or not, and how you think, what you think about it. And, you know, just I'd like to hear from your audience if they get a moment to send me an email or something.
Beautiful, beautiful. Well, that is What Is Up. Thank you again for being on the show, and we look forward to talking to you again.
Okay, thank you, Tori. Love you.
All right, love you too.
Okay, bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Yes. So I hope you all really enjoyed that and were able to drink in and get some of those pearls of wisdom, and that you also heard her compassion and her commitment to our community. Michele Hoskins said more than one time during the interview of her willingness to help others to achieve success, and her availability, her openness to be able to counsel and talk to others about how they can get their product on shelves, how they can achieve the type of success that she has. So don't waste any time, brothers and sisters. It's a new year, and it's time. I know people are sitting home with a product or an idea, and they're thinking about how and what and when and where. And look, just get started. Just get started, get moving. Get the fear out. Get the fear out and go ahead and make something happen. So that's what's up. So we thank Michele for being on the show. And in these few, it is what, 3:52. And you are listening to Bean Soup Times Radio. I am your host, Tori Muhammad. And we are coming up on the last few minutes of the show. And I want to share very quickly a personal experience. This year, matter of fact, you know what? Let me say it like this. I have not eaten this year. I have been since December 31st. You know, yeah, I know that a lot of people were out eating and drinking and enjoying New Year's Eve and doing all that we do to usher in a new year, whether you were doing it at a watch party in the church where it was clean and wholesome, or whether you were out somewhere in the streets rebelling. I know some people don't know.